I'm Ed Fries here for Ring Scoops, and I'm here with your NXT May 10th, 2022 review. NXT tonight was all about the ladies as they took over the show, and we're going to get right into it. But don't forget to leave a like on the video, comment down below with your thoughts on NXT, hit the subscribe button, and click on the bell to make sure that you get all of your Ring Scoop notifications every time we have a review or video go live. Tonight's show started with Toxic Attraction and defeating Wendy Chu and Roxanne Perez in an NXT Women's Tag Team title match. This was a really fun match. The girls really went out there and killed it tonight. These four in particular really had a really great showing out there. Everybody had a lot of chemistry. Wendy Chu is really good in the ring. Roxanne Perez is just a star. And Toxic Attraction is gaining more and more chemistry as they go. The match ends when Mandy Rose, for some reason, gets in the ring. She gets tackled by Wendy Chu. And while Wendy Chu is beating down on Mandy Rose on the corner of the ring, while Roxanne has Gigi Dolin in a code red situation, JC Jane goes ahead and kicks her in the head, and Gigi Dolin gets the 1-2-3 to retain the women's tag team titles. Great match. And in this match, we had five women featured on the card. That's 5 of 20 that will be featured throughout the night. We then had Tiffany Stratton and Grayson Waller out and about shopping and talking to each other about how much they dislike Chase University. Great little segment, gets us ready for the Chase versus Grayson Waller match, which will eventually be changed, but we'll get to that in just a bit. We then see Joe Gacy coming to the ring with the Druids, but when we come back from commercial break, we go to Roderick Strong and the Creed Brothers backstage. Creed Brothers are still upset about how they won their match last week and said that they want another crack at the Viking Raiders, this time without Roderick Strong getting involved. And Roderick Strong says that, well, that's fine, but he's adding a new member to the Diamond Mine to make sure that everything keeps going the way he wants, and it's Damon Kemp. For anybody who doesn't know, Damon Kemp is the younger brother of Gable Steveson, so it's nice to see that they're getting him involved in NXT and getting him some training coming out of the University of Minnesota as well. After this, we had the Gacy promo, and for a lot of this, I was paying attention, waiting for the names to come for the two Druids that were behind him, because he was talking about how two people have stepped above and beyond and have understood him and have locked into his beliefs and are following him. And they had the two Druids standing behind him, and I thought he was going to pull off their hoods and we were going to see who they were, but they weren't. They didn't. They just kept going on and on. And it was fine. It was a really good promo by Joe Gacy talking about the changes that are coming to NXT and how he wants to still be the NXT champion. And he talks about Bron Breakker and Bron Breakker coming to him and joining his cause. We'll see the Bron Breakker's response to that next week, but it was another good segment. We then have Andre Chase backstage talking to Bodhi when Saray comes running in and starts screaming at him in Japanese. It's really fun. I love when they allow these other nationalities to come in here and use their native language that they can get over so they don't have to stumble in English. I think it's a really good cause. This one's even funnier because Andre Chase stops her and he goes, look, I'm sorry. I just don't understand what you're saying. I don't understand Japanese. And Bodhi's like, no, Mr. Chase, I can tell you what she's saying. And she goes ahead and says that she wants to join him and have it be a mixed tag. And he's like, Bodhi, how do you understand Japanese? And Bodhi's like, well, I'm taking the Chase University, you know, Japanese 202 course. And he's like, I didn't even know we had a foreign language department. It's really great. Andre Chase is so, so funny without even really trying to be. He's kind of a funny gimmick, but I really wish they could do more with him at the top of the card. But I have a bad feeling that he's going to end up like Heath Slater or an R-Truth, where they find him this great role as a comedian, and he never really gets to have the best of what he can do. We then had a series of segments throughout the night with the Ivy Nile Challenge. I'm going to go ahead and cover all of them here, but they were throughout the night segments, little, you know, 2 or 3 minute segments throughout the night. I thought it was going to be an open challenge, but it was really just a physical workout challenge, and it started with push-ups and it went to burpees, and then they were running, and it ended with pull-ups. And Ivy Nile basically says that she's going to outlast all these other guys who are doing all the workouts with her, and she does. And she, it just shows how strong and tough and how much resiliency she has to be able to do all this when all the guys sit here and quit. We then had the breakout tournament introductions of Nikita Lyons, Sloane Jacobs, Kiana James, Ariana Grace, Fallon Henley, Lash Legend, Roxanne Perez, and the last member of the tournament, who is Tatum Paxley. Sorry about that. Almost forgot. And so all the girls got introduced and they were given, you know, a little bit of backstory on each one of them. And then we had the first match from the breakout tournament, which was Fallon Henley defeating Sloane Jacobs. Unfortunately, this match didn't go over as well as I would like. I thought it was going to be a really, really great match, but unfortunately, Sloane just wasn't quite, they didn't have the quite chemistry that they needed. Sloane looked like sometimes she was kicking and she was just kicking air, and Fallon Henley was still selling for her. It didn't quite mesh the way I wanted to. That being said, it was a pretty decent, okay match, but I've just, when you're putting these girls on this level and they're so young and they're so green, that sometimes it just, you get these matches where they don't quite hit home runs. This one felt like one of those. But at this point, we've now had 13 women featured on the card. And that's really good considering we're not even out of the first hour yet. We then had an Legado del Fantasma backstage segment where he's talking to Mackenzie Mitchell, and he's talking about how he was disrespected by Tony D'Angelo when he brought in somebody from the outside like AJ Galante in. But once he was brought into this whole thing, he became fair game. And they kidnapped AJ Galante, and they're making jokes about it and everything else. But you know something bad's about to happen. He tells Cruz to go get the car, and we leave for commercial break. When we come back from the commercial break, we see Tony D'Angelo and the boys kidnap Cruz del Toro and throw him in the track seat of the trunk of the car. I did like how Two Dimes and Stax wanted to throw him in the garbage, and Tony's like, no, we're going to make a statement. We're going to kidnap him like they kidnapped AJ Galante. We then had a promo for Alba Fire having her re-debut match tonight, and it was going to be next. When we come back from commercial break, we have Amari Miller in the ring, and I'm like, oh, this is great. Amari Miller's coming out. She's going to go ahead and get a win so that she can go ahead and get back on track. And then remembered she was facing Alba Fire and realized that was absolutely not going to happen. But this was a really good match. Amari Miller got a ton in this match. Alba Fire really, really did a good job of giving as much as she could in this match. For those who don't know, Alba Fire is the new name for Kay Lee Ray. And she's got this new name, the new gimmick, the new music. It's all really good, actually, believe it or not. The name is still, I like it, but a lot of people don't. That being said, they have a great backstory talking about how it's about rebirth and her going back to her past, and if it was a part of her past that she was running away from. So I really enjoy all of that about this character. We then see Trick Mello showing up almost an hour into the show, and Solo Sikoa tries to keep them out of the show by closing the door and telling them that they're not getting in. They decide to try to go in a different way. We then had a Cora Jade backstage promo where we see the 18th person, 19th if you've been counting Mackenzie Mitchell through all this. 18 women on this show at this point, and this is the hour break. Cora Jade in this promo talks about how she's so nervous about going up against a legend like Natalya, about a future Hall of Famer, but she still wants to make sure that she gets the win tonight in the main event. Solo Sikoa goes out to the ring and steals Trick Mello's interview time and says that he wants to be the next one to challenge Cameron Grimes for the North American Championship. He doesn't care what anybody has to say about it. Cameron Grimes then comes down to the ring and tells him that In Your House, coming up in the near future, it's going to be Cameron Grimes versus Carmelo Hayes at that show for the North American Championship. But Cameron Grimes says, when I defeat him, you get to have your next shot. I don't have a problem with putting you next in line. Solo Sikoa seems okay with that and starts walking away. As he's walking away, Trick and Mello get into the arena, and they go ahead and start attacking Cameron Grimes. Really, really cool moment here with the cameras, where they show Solo Sikoa looking over his back shoulder and watching Cameron Grimes get attacked. And the camera cuts away and you think he's just going to keep walking. And then all of a sudden, Carmelo's Hayes' eyes get real big and you realize that Solo Sikoa is coming for the save. Solo Sikoa does make the save and he goes ahead and picks up the North American Championship and gets ready to raise it when Cameron Grimes walks over and grabs it back and holds it up himself. These three guys are still in a feud, and I'm so excited to see where this goes because these three could continue feuding for the next few months, and I'd be entirely entertained by it because these three are all having great matches with each other. Legado del Fantasma finds out that Cruz has been kidnapped, and I think it's great. Joaquin Wilde is like, Electra, did he call you? And he's like, no, of course he didn't call you. Well, no, of course he didn't. The doors were all open. What do you think? He went for a coffee and left all the doors open and the car on with the keys in it? No, of course he didn't. This NXT's parking lot is the most dangerous place in the entire world. Everybody gets attacked there. Everybody gets kidnapped there. Legado del Fantasma as a group was started because Joaquin Wilde and Raul Mendoza, now Cruz del Toro, got kidnapped by Santos Escobar. I mean, come on. After this, we see Santos Escobar call Tony D'Angelo, and Tony D'Angelo pretends like he doesn't know who it is. And then he goes back and forth with Santos Escobar, and they're both trying to get under each other's skin, both talking about how they have one of each of theirs kidnapped, and they're going to have a match next week. I'm very excited to finally see these two get in the ring and actually duke it out there. We then have the Chase U match, where Andre Chase and Saray defeated Grayson Waller and Tiffany Stratton. I was actually surprised by that finish. I really thought Tiffany Stratton and Grayson Waller would get the win. Grayson Waller has been eating a bunch of losses lately, and I thought he could use a win here. But it was nice to see that Bode goes ahead and uses the air horn to distract the referee while Grayson Waller has Tiffany Stratton has the pin for the win. And then Tiffany Stratton is distracted by all of this, and Saray gets to roll her up for the win. One of the interesting things about this is when Saray came out to do her schoolgirl through the curtain, comes out warrior goddess in ring look. Not only did she, when she walked out with Andre Chase and Bode from that, not only did she change, but both of them did. Andre Chase now has on a powder blue Chase University shirt that I would love to get my hands on. I think that would be great. I would wear that everywhere. The powder blue one just looked fantastic. And Bode Hayward is dressed like a cheerleader, essentially, with a crop top. And it was just fantastic. And I just can't imagine the pitch meeting with Triple H sitting there trying to explain to these three that this is how that segment's going to go. We then had a backstage segment with Nathan Frazier being interviewed by Mackenzie Mitchell, where he's interrupted by Zion Quinn. And Zion Quinn is trying to talk down to him and tell him that, you know, to remember that, you know, to keep his eyes open around here. And Nathan Frazier's like, cool, that's great, nice to meet you, all that kind of stuff. And then Zion Quinn says the same line that confused Wes Lee. And Nathan Frazier goes, I got no idea what you're talking about. And Wes Lee comes in interfering as well and says, see, somebody else who doesn't get it. And this sets up Zion Quinn versus Wes Lee for next week as well. Great to see these two back at it. It's great to see Zion Quinn back on TV after being not medically cleared a couple weeks ago. So it's nice to see all of them back on here. I'm excited to see where Wesley goes in this solo career as they try to figure out what to do with him after everything that's happened with Nash Carter. We then had an interview segment with Von Wagner and Robert Stone talking about how they've injured Ika Manjiro and how they injured Brooks Jensen. And Robert Stone is doing all this and talking about how Von Wagner is so deadly. And then he's jumped by Ika Manjiro, who's apparently not as injured as they thought he was. And they finally get them spread apart. But this was great. I liked Ika Manjiro coming back out of surprise. I like how he's eager to beat him up. I like how he's eager to take him on after because she decided not to renew his contract, and how all of a sudden Ika Manjiro's friend is no longer here. We then have Ariana Grace versus Nikita Lyons backstage. And this was fun. It was just a nice little backstage segment showing how each of them are getting ready for the match. And they have the match, and Nikita Lyons defeats Ariana Grace. And I was a little bit surprised by this. The bracket is made up weird with the different colors and the lines not exactly showing you that it's a left and right bracket. I thought it was an up and down bracket, so I thought that they might have Nikita Lyons lose here with distractions from, say, a Lash Legend or a Natalya getting ready for her main event, because they've been involved in with each other's stuff going forward. But Nikita wins, and the prize for this is a women's championship match or a tag team championship match. So it'll be interesting to see who else makes the finals. But now we have next week, Fallon Henley versus, not next week, but in the next round, it'll be Fallon Henley versus Nikita Lyons. And I'm excited to see what happens there. We then had Toxic Attraction and Mandy Rose walking up to Indy Hartwell, who's still sad. And they had them making fun of, you know, oh, I can never imagine, you know, what you're going through. And she's like, yeah, I'm so sad and I'm so lonely. And she's like, no, no, I just couldn't imagine a man leaving me. She's like, I'm Mandy Rose. Men don't leave me. I leave them. And, you know, they make it out to be a nice little joke. And they're like, you should go make friends with, you know, Wendy Chu and those losers like that with Roxanne Perez. And I can see that we're getting ready to build to a six-woman tag, and we're getting ready to build to maybe Wendy Chu and Indy Hartwell tag team while we don't have anything going on after the releases of Persia Parada and Dexter Lumis. We had the finishing up of the Ivy Nile challenge when she defeats the other gentleman in the pull-ups. And then Natalya in the main event defeats Cora Jade. And this was a fun match, full of all those famous heart spots that you know and love from Natalya, with, you know, wrapping the leg around the ring post and banging it on it, going ahead and trying to do the hanging figure four. Didn't quite work out, but it was one of those great spots, and it was always good. Cora Jade still doesn't get the win. She kind of passes out. She doesn't tap out. And Natalya, you know, respects that and goes ahead and picks her up and gives her a handshake and a hug at the end of the match. And the show goes off the air. The ladies absolutely had a great night tonight. They went out there and they killed it. 20 women on the show. Throughout the show, every match that was on the card tonight had a woman in it in some way, shape, or form. So it was really good to showcase the women of NXT, especially when everybody's talking about women's wrestling and how good and bad it can be, to show them out there and having them in matches and to have different types of matches where you have some comedy gimmicks and you have some sexy gimmicks and you have some serious gimmicks and girls who are taking themselves seriously. It's just great to see all these different varieties all coming together into one show. NXT tonight was a fantastic show. Remember to follow Ring Scoops and check out me here at EdFries12584 on Twitter. You can also catch me on Love Wrestling every Tuesday night for NXT, where me and a couple of friends go through the show in our thoughts in long form, talking about all the different things that happen on NXT. But I will catch you next week. Goodbye.